Welcome to the Daily Glasgow Cappuccino. Start each day of COP26 by drinking in a few minutes of warm, stimulating conversation about climate resilience. I'm your host, Peter Willis from The Resilience Shift. Shall we begin? My guest on this morning's cappuccino is Juliet Meehan. Juliet is a civil engineer who's been with ARUP, the global design, engineering and architecture firm, for more than 25 years and is currently global leader of ARUP's City Resilience Skills Network, where she steers knowledge, innovation and research for her ARUP colleagues across multiple sectors. I've come to know Juliet as a colleague over the last 3 years in her role as the Deputy Director of the Resilience Shift, the not-for-profit initiative to enhance the resilience of critical infrastructure, which ARUP has been leading and delivering. Welcome, Juliet. Now, you've been involved for a number of years in promoting, thinking about, and framing infrastructure resilience. And I know you've begun to think much more widely than purely infrastructure in the traditional sense. I wonder whether you can share with me and our listeners a moment that you saw something somewhere and you thought, ha, that. Now, that is a really excellent example of resilient thinking and execution.
Finding these examples and sharing them, we can't do enough of, because I tell you what else it's very easy to find, and that's examples of a lack of resilience and examples of failure. And often they get a lot of attention. The successes and the good practice don't. And as we're trying to sort of scale up and bring more people into this field of delivering resilience, the ask is always, well, what does it look like? What is a good example? For me, there were some fascinating lessons and good examples from how we globally responded to the COVID pandemic, which we should be sort of using and building on. There were many examples at different scales of resilience in practice, and also, being honest, examples of a lack of resilience or failures of, you know, sort of fragmentation of decision making. One of the things for me with COVID particularly, because a lot of my focus has been on the resilience of infrastructure, typically thinking about physical shocks and stresses, whether that's earthquakes or storms or floods. There was no physical impact on COVID. So we got to really, from COVID, we got to really see how people were fundamentally important to the functioning of our infrastructure systems and of our wider systems. Here in the UK, in the very early stages of the pandemic, one of the things we saw was people like my mum saying, what can I do? And starting to make PPE for the healthcare workers. And it's just the kind of thing that however many models or digital twins or systems mapping we think, it shows how the sort of systems approach and uncertainty and things that you can't predict and some of those things really help. There's another great example and stories, Peter, and this is something that you and I worked on together, collecting the stories around Cape Town's Day Zero water crisis and the way in that case that different actors, organisations, individuals took action, that when you bring those together creates a collective response. And I think any system is made up of so many different parts and elements, how we get the system to respond in a resilient way, not simply individuals.
I'm fascinated by that, what you just said there about your mum, really, about how all the engineering and the sort of mathematical modelling of risk and disaster and so on can get upended by the subtle human and communal decisions and effects. Over the years that you've been grappling with this question of how do we become much more resilient to a very dangerous future, I'm guessing that your mind has changed and grown, and what you think of as the quintessential elements of a resilience mindset. I'd love to know what you now regard as the absolute must-haves of a resilience awareness.
Yeah, and actually, Peter, it is exactly that. So I'm a civil engineer, have been working in engineering for sort of 20 plus years. I used to assume that resilience was all about the sort of physical performance of our infrastructure systems. I then, through COVID, through other examples, realized no, it's not. It's all about the people. And I'd actually say where I am now, it's about the physical parts, the people, and the natural environment. And only by looking at resilience in that big picture can you really get that mindset. In terms of what's needed to be a resilience expert, I remember someone saying at an event I was at several years ago, if you think you've got resilience, then it's time to get your coat, because you're wrong. So to me, probably one of the most important parts of a resilience mindset, something that I love about the sort of practice and discipline, is no one person can understand all of it. No one individual, one organization can have all the answers. We need a lot of different people, different disciplines, different organizations. The failures will come wherever the weakest point is. So, you know, even for me as an engineer, if I solve the engineering aspects, there's the community, the governance, the funding. So I think that's the most important thing, and for nobody to assume that this is something that, you know, ask Juliet, she gets resilience. I wouldn't say that I would be the right person on my own. You have to assemble a group.
Isn't that interesting that we've moved beyond the, you know, that you can go and get a degree and then a master's and a qualification as a certified resilience officer or whatever, that you sort of, is there a resilience officer in the house? We'll go, you know, she'll sort it out for you. And that actually it's what you're describing is more of a process, actually, a really robust process. And what I'm hearing is that it involves both diversity of experience and perspective, and Johan Rockström, when I interviewed him for the Cappuccino, was talking about the rapidity of communication and learning and failing, which again is not something we're used to professionally in our silos and so on. Yeah. Would you go along with that?
Completely, yes. Again, coming back to sort of my training and discipline as an engineer, something many of my colleagues do tell me is, Juliet, you're making this too difficult. And I think that's one of our challenges. It is difficult. It has to be difficult because there's a sort of phrase, if we're too reductionist about this, then we're not really building in things like rapidity of response, of just being ready for uncertainty, just accepting that we've got our models, they're helpful, we don't know what individuals will do, and we're okay with that. That's part of the response. So I think one of the challenges is everyone gets that resilience is important, but how we really sort of build this into thinking and practice when it has so many different aspects. And we have, again, coming back to the good examples, being able to tell the stories, being able to show what we mean. Pre-COVID, I used to talk a lot about globally interconnected systems and deep uncertainty, and I get that they're difficult concepts. Post-COVID, it's much easier to point to what we mean by a globally interconnected systems and what we mean by deep uncertainty. So those stories and examples really, really matter.
So my last question then is, to look forward, what are you, just let's say for the next year, what's your greatest hope for this field that you're a thought leader and a very busy activist in, of resilience, the development of resilience? What would be a really good outcome for the end of this year?
I am very optimistic, because as we're coming up to COP, we've with the Resilience Shift and Partners established the Resilience Hub at the COP, which is somewhere where so many people from different organizations and different fields of resilience, whether it's locally led adaptation or cities and the built environment or food and agriculture, are all coming together. So there's a real drive to talk about resilience. I think one of the changes that we're seeing now is in the sort of climate action dialogue, there's a race to zero and there's a race to resilience, and they need to be considered together. Really important that we don't ever put down the race to zero and start saying it's all about resilience. That's not the future we want to see. It's a future where we do everything we can to reduce emissions and at the same time do everything we can to build resilience to climate change. And that's where we'll get to the, you know, the 2050, where communities are surviving and thriving and there is, you know, low carbon and working with nature. So for me, over the next year, it's a question of building the momentum, keeping all these people talking together, forming collaborations, coming back to my point of not all trying to do this on our own. If we were to see by COP27, resilience is really up there as being of equal importance, as I say, without ever putting down the importance of the net zero.
Well, I wish that to be true, and all strength to you in your journey through the coming year. Many thanks, Juliet.
It was fun. Thank you.